Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am here to interact with you on behalf of Dr. Falinder Kumar Sudhan, professor, Department of Economics, Jammu University. I am going to talk about the module Population and Land Degradation from Demography of Climate Adaptation. So students, we are going to discuss about the relationship between population and land degradation. We will also discuss the policy recommendations which can improve the population-land relationship. Rapid population growth put the land resources under severe stress. Most of the environmentalists have taken the causal effect of population growth on land degradation. Overpopulation leads to decline in the natural resources such as land. With high population, land is more intensively used, land resources are overexploited, leading to its degradation, decline in soil fertility, and its precious resources. The simple solution to the problem lies in checking growing population and using better and improved technologies. These could make resource use more efficient, leading to higher land productivity and also lower the costs. In population dynamics, this two-dimensional approach has limited scope as far as land usage and land management is concerned. According to the classical theories of human and cultural ecology, the human population relates to its environment through the cultural and organizational framework. These organizational structures are changing with changes in the demographic profile. This has numerous effects on environment, land use pattern, and land quality. Therefore, stopping only the population growth or looking for technological advancements and innovations in the resource management would not be enough. There is a need to explain the mechanism that join these two variables which need to be identified. These population mechanisms consist of the social, cultural, and economic aspects. All these issues affect the land attributes due to the demographic pressures in developing countries. The population pressure and the rapid development aspect influence the demographic profile. So, with this background, this module has the following objectives: to understand the basics of population and land degradation dynamics, to analyze the relationship between population and land degradation, to explore the intermediate level variables responsible for population-land relationships, and to suggest policy recommendation to improve the population-land relationships. Structure of land holding. Structure of land holding needs immediate attention. The physical and social dimensions affect the land usage and land quality. The physical dimension includes the size of holdings, its fragmentation and fragility. The social dimension includes the land tenure, including its use and ownership rights. The rapid population growth puts excess burden on the scarce resources of land, which rebuild the physical and social attributes. The changes in physical and social framework cause land degradation indirectly through their impact on land management practices, including land use, conservation technologies, fertilizers, lime, and other inputs. How the pressure building up from the population growth may lead to changing physical and social attributes, how the changing patterns actually result into soil degradation are the important questions. In this context, the traditional perspectives given by Malthus and Bostrup on population and agricultural intensification are incomplete, as their theories do not incorporate the significance and relevance of intermediaries into population land degradation dynamics. Resource scarcity and land. Earth system provides the humans and all other living creatures their food and livelihood. Man adapts and alters the environment to suit his needs. The adaptation mechanism depends on the resources at his disposal. According to Bostrup, the resource constraint has resulted in specialization, tools, skill and knowledge, and division of labor to meet basic needs from the resources. The successful association between man and environment depends on the balance between man's demand and the environment's ability to supply resources. The balance between the man and environment could be achieved by keeping the low population growth to replenish the nature indefinitely. Otherwise, a culture system is required to manage the environment to increase the supply of renewable resources artificially. The delicate balance between man and environment gets disturbed if the population continues to grow at unmanageable levels. In this context, the proponents of Malthusian doctrine say that population increases will eventually reduce food surpluses, arrest agricultural development, lead to starvation and other positive checks. Bostrup presented the opposite point of view. According to her, the population pressures actually lead to agricultural intensification and increased productivity. The population pressures lead to specialization, division of labor, technological advancement, and an increasing per hectare output from land. Both Malthus and Bostrup's model suffer from weaknesses. For instance, Bostrup does not analyze the physical framework of land holdings, such as fragility or size. However, she takes into account the social attribute of land, such as the land tenure. According to her, when population increases, farmers tend to shift from collecting farming to individual farming. The individual farming technique gives more incentive to the farmer to invest in the land and to increase the returns, thereby increasing the soil productivity. This seems very logical, yet some questions remain unanswered. How long soil productivity increase would continue? How long would the additional population pressures go on increasing the land productivity? Whether this is sustainable are the questions to be answered. The population pressure has resulted in shifting to individual farming system, which has actually done very little to lessen the land degradation of formerly collectively operated lands. This has further increased the disparity in the size and distribution of land holdings. Moreover, in countries where this shift has occurred, new patterns of land ownership and farming patterns have emerged, such as the tenant farming and absentee ownership. Let us discuss the case of Rwandan farmers. The Rwandan farmers, for instance, now rent 18.7% of all land operated, which is estimated as an increase of about 1% per year since 1983. The land tenants are less likely to invest in the soil conservation techniques than the land owners and are less likely to use their land for pasture or fallow. These land practices are not environmentally safe compared to annual crop production. Therefore, there has been a short-term gain in land productivity increase but is non-sustainable. The problem of diminishing size of land holdings is quite apparent in developing countries. The population pressure results into the division of the size of land holding. In countries such as Malawi, Rwanda, Haiti, and Bangladesh, population growth rates are very high. With rapid population increase in these countries, the declining farm size and landlessness may reach staggering proportions. Besides, the fragmentation of land holding is another factor responsible for decreasing size of land holdings. The fragmentation is concerned with the geographical dispersion of land. The greater the dispersion, the greater would be the time spent on reaching and managing these fragmented lands. This invariably leads to high opportunity costs and lesser agricultural productivity. There is significant variation in the number of these dispersed land holdings that farmers operate and the time they spend to reach them. In Rwanda, for instance, there is strong correlation between fragmentation and dispersion of land holdings. The average distance traveled by farmers with 10 or more dispersed lands is 14.8 minutes compared to 7.1 minutes for those with fewer than 5 dispersed lands. The farther the land holdings are from one another, the greater are the chances that they would be rented out. This breaks the ownership-usage relationship. Now it is interesting to discuss land scarcity and cultivation of marginal lands. Due to land scarcity, the farmers try to use whatever small piece of land they can cultivate to support their families. Therefore, the farmers expand into frontier lands or clear and cultivate their own pastures, etc. The more cultivation of marginal lands and the subsequent degradation is a common phenomena in densely populated countries. In the past, these marginal and fragile lands were left as forest lands or pastures or long fallow lands. The rapid population growth compels the small poor farmers to the fragile ecosystems to produce food crops to support their families. The four different but interconnected dimensions of the structure of land holdings are the farm size, dispersion, soil fragility, and tenure. The high population pressure has resulted into decrease in the size of the land holdings. This has forced the farmers to look for distant lands, which are considered ecologically fragile. Since the land holdings are smaller and the dependent family members are large, which force the farmers to rent the distant land holdings to others to supplement their incomes. Land management and degradation. The land management practices include investments to improve productivity and conservation, as well as patterns of land use. Investment in productivity and conservation refers to the innovative practice used for irrigation, seed improvement, chemical fertilizers, and soil conservation techniques. It also refers to a transition from the traditional agriculture, such as usage of manures, to more modern farming methods. Land usage pattern refers to following practices, that is, duration and amount of land, cropping patterns, types of crops grown, multiple cropping, intercropping, the pastoral practices, and the agroforestry. The land tenure defines farmers' access to land resources and conditions, the decisions they make about how to use land. It influences the farmers' investment decisions. The land tenure systems have an intermediate role in population pressure and land degradation relationship. The common ownership of land and resources bring inefficiency and land degradation. This causes the free rider problem, where none is actually willing to invest for the cause of common property. The farmers overuse a common property to compete with other users. The overuse of soil eventually leads to severe land degradation. Other view is that the common lands do not necessarily attract degradation. Rather, an irresponsible attitude of the sharecroppers cause land degradation. At the same time, strong cultural and ethical bond may prevent them from doing so. Everyone actually ends up doing better for the soil upgradation and conservation. The traditional land tenure systems in the Amazon region is undergoing a rapid restructuring of land holding. According to Bostrup, the land system actually evolves from the common ownership framework to individual ownership. The population pressure will further boost individual land ownership system, which would increase agricultural productivity and improve land use pattern. But the individual land ownership could lead to other problems, such as the concentration of land in the hands of the few, resulting in rental land system, where the have-nots would rent the land from the haves. This could possibly reduce the incentive on the part of the farmers who have rented the land to invest in land conservation and increase the chances of land degradation. The case of sub-Saharan Africa is very interesting. In Ghana, the investment behavior of farmers depends on the security of land tenure. The farmers are more likely to improve lands if they own lands or have long-term use rights than on lands they operate under short-term use rights. Compared to farmers in Ghana, the Kenyan farmers with more assured land tenure are more willing to invest in their holdings. The land tenure arrangements among small farmers in Java show that under certain conditions, sharecropping was not a deterrent to investment. A review of agroforestry practices in sub-Saharan Africa further shows that it is not clear whether individual ownership motivates farmers to invest in agroforestry and technologies for soil conservation. Similarly, we can also look at the case of United States. The relationship between tenancy and soil conservation investment in the United States reveals that it is wrong to pre-identify common ownership as a detrimental factor in land conservation. It would be wrong to presuppose that the sharecroppers have no incentive to invest in the lands. Other factors determining the level of investment in the land are whether the tenant is a family member, a neighbor, or aspires to purchase or inherit the land. The stability of ownership and its duration affects the farmer's decision to invest in soil productivity. It thus becomes clear that it is not the common ownership or individual ownership rights which degrade land. The secure land tenure over a time period will give confidence to the farmer to invest in soil and land conservation techniques. Insecure land tenure systems give rise to a short-term benefit ideology among tenants. It is a duration and stability of land tenure that is far more important than the mode of ownership itself. Farm size. Farm size is another factor governing the land usage and land conservation. The large farm holders have surplus lands, which they could put to non-agricultural or non-food crop production use. They can set aside a large proportion of their holdings for other land use practices that help control soil loss and fertility depletion. The ownership of large landholding makes them comparatively wealthier, thus enabling them to invest more on the land conservation techniques and raising long-term land productivity. Small landholders also have their share of advantage because of the abundant labor that they process. They can use their labor to construct and maintain terraces, hedgerows, drainage ditches, and other soil conservation measures. In the situation where the family continues to expand, they might end up closer to the margin and at greater risk. According to Bostrup, due to additional population pressure, the size of the holdings is bound to fall eventually. Thus, the duration of lands which are left uncultivated and fallow has to be reduced. Though other variables such as better yielding seeds, fertilizers, and better irrigation facilities could substitute the duration of the lands kept uncultivated. Now let us look at the case of Mexico and Central and South America. The correlation between the intensity of drought and the size of land holdings has been portrayed in the context of small farmers in the state of Sonora, Mexico. Small farmers are more vulnerable than large holders to the effects of drought. Small farmers with their meager resources can invest very less on soil conservation and soil productivity techniques. Lower investment reflects the high poverty among small farmers. Conversely, in many parts of Central and South America, an inverse relationship between farm size and intensity of land use has been observed. This is particularly true where labor inputs are the crucial factor. According to Bostrup, when population increases, the farm size becomes smaller and the cropping pattern more intense. The environment and land degradation happens when population exceeds the carrying capacity of land. In the context of increasing population and the resultant fall in the size of land holdings, the practice of multiple cropping is very common, which requires additional doses of chemical fertilizers, seeds, and other inputs that large farm holders are more likely to afford compared to the small farmers. The input cost increases in multiple cropping system. The farmers are more likely to substitute the low yielding crops with high yielding crops to gain from return on their investment. Multiple cropping may prove beneficial in the short run, but ultimately it contributes to decreasing soil fertility. Another cropping pattern is intercropping, which involves planting multiple crops in proximity such that none actually interferes in the growth of the others. This strategy could prove quite efficient in increasing the crop yields without incurring additional cost and would prosper in areas where the owners are endowed with large farm size. Instead, most of the large farm size owners, when adopting the modern high-end agriculture technology, invariably focus on a single high-yielding crop production. This causes loss of local biodiversity and makes the plants vulnerable to the attacks of pests and weeds. Due to the population pressure and small land holdings, small farm holders fall back to intercropping as a mean to secure livelihood. Fragmentation. The views of the agriculturist and the environmentalist are similar regarding fragmentation of land holdings into smaller sizes and its impact on the land productivity. There is the problem of maneuvering machinery for bigger farms and smaller size of land. There are production losses due to high ratio of field edges to total area. However, according to the supporters of fragmentation, diverse lands are spatially distributed, giving an option of crop diversity and better chances of crop success. The literature talks about the impact of smaller farm size on productivity, but it doesn't focus much on how fragmentation influences land use. Investment strategies and productivity. The Angola region of Ghana provides an exception. The farmers of this region are more likely to invest labor and capital in the farms, which are closer to their homes. These lands are more prone to damage from heavy rains, thus requiring more investment in flood prevention and repair. Thus, the susceptibility to rain damage could be identified as one important factor in the farmer's decision to invest in nearby fields. However, one cannot rule out the possibility that the cost involved in shifting the labor and other inputs to distant areas could be one of the determining factors in opting for nearby fields. A second exception is the returns to investments in soil conservation. The returns on investment are greater from the nearby farms than the farther ones. Although the land fragmentation gives greater scope of crop diversity, the increased input costs might make such a proposition non-lucrative. The simple cost-benefit analysis would ensure that people would prefer the nearby community fields. The farm fragmentation as a demographically induced change in a landholding structure is therefore integral to our understanding of how population pressure can lead to land degradation. Fragility. The fragility of land means exploitation of land resource in fragile environment, where any outside disturbance can have devastating consequences to the natural habitat and land quality. With increasing population pressure in the least developed countries, the farmers are moving towards the marginal land sites. This becomes their necessity to support livelihoods of their families. In search of better land to secure improved livelihoods, the farmers tend to move from their native environment to the external fragile environment, which invariably ends up in exploitation of these lands and the ecosystems. The population pressure and land scarcity have also caused the movement of farming community to the fragile and marginal lands, which were traditionally kept untouched. The intensive use of these fragile lands by the cultivators and farmers has caused environmental damage. Due to rapid population growth, these fragile lands are being intensively cultivated. Most of this region falls in the hill or mountain slope region. A loss of conventional forest and vegetation cover exposes the land to wind and water-based soil erosion. It results in ever-increasing input costs to maintain farm productivity. This causes a downward spiral of low production and low investment. Different crops have different climatic and nutrient requirements and differ in terms of level of soil protection and biomass. With abundant land or lower population, the farmers have the luxury to choose the appropriate crop and cropping pattern. But once the land becomes scarce, farmers have to move to the marginal lands. Besides, the market conditions greatly influence the cropping decision of the farmers. The favorable market signals and forces the farmer to cultivate crop in an ill-suited environment. Moreover, with technological change or degradation, farmers adapt agricultural practices suitable to new conditions or by moving into ever more fragile environment. In the Amazon region, the marginal patches are experiencing intense cultivation. The demographic pressure is the main determinant of this trend. The short-term intensive cultivation and large pasture tracts for cattle have replaced indigenous agriculture based on long fallow cycles. The deforestation in the Amazon has encouraged migration to the region. The rural unemployment and landlessness has forced the new generation to move to fragile areas in search of livelihood. Now we can discuss about certain policy issues. The demographic pressures are responsible for degradation of soil and land. This has straightforward policy implications. First is to reduce the fertility rates and use of efficient technology to increase farm productivity. Besides, there is a need to focus on soil and environment conservation. Besides demography, a host of intermediaries called structure of landholding is important. These intermediaries include the physical association of tillers, farmers, and herders to the social milieu. The physical and social dynamics govern the relationship between the population growth and land degradation. A mounting geographic pressure affects and alters the structure of landholding. Many households have experienced a diminishing farm size due to increasing population size. Land ownership has little consequences on the degree of environmental degradation. What matters is the security of tenure. The population pressure has left many farmers landless. Due to demographic pressure, available land is divided into smaller per capita land. Smaller farm sizes attract intensive mode of cultivation and strategies which could give higher yield per hectare. Small land owners are well equipped to adopt practices that require significant cash outlays and access to credit. The fragmentation of land causes the farm size to shrink. The spatial distribution of land has involved high costs, which are in the form of extra time being spent on movement and the transfer of input resources from one piece of land to another. Farmers tend to invest lesser in the far-flung land. On the other hand, fragmentation gives farmers a better chance of crop success. The other aspect is that of fragility of the marginal lands. The demographic pressures forces farmers to enter the environmentally fragile land. Due to increasing need for newer and cultivable lands, these ecological fragile areas have come under tremendous pressure. With the expansion and growth of these regions and greater accessibility to modern means and irrigation, the earlier non-accessible areas are now being cultivated. So students, let us sum up what we have learned from this module. In case of distant and less stable lands, cost-benefit ratios of conservation technologies will become less favorable to farmers, resulting in increasing land degradation. The demographic pressure may not necessarily and directly cause land degradation. In a system where the changing land holding structure due to population growth is checked, land degradation could be avoided, which is easier said than done. The subdivision and consolidation of land holdings, absentee land holding, and use of fragile lands are all parts of the structure of land holding. These aspects are really hard to alter. Moreover, due to the varied socio-cultural, agro-climatic, and historical conditions of different countries of the world, a uniform solution is inapplicable. We mostly focus on family planning methods to reduce population so as to curb its evil effects on land. A change in land policy governing the ownership rights of land and other contracts such as lease and renting could have serious effect on the family decisions of the landowners. A policy framework which focuses on population reduction and environmental protection in isolation of one another would not help. Therefore, it is needed to look into the role of the intermediaries involved. That's all with today's lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed it. Thank you.